there are two people are in two camps. One is they're playing with Copilot, and the other one, what is generative AI, right? Mm-hmm. So, and those who are in the what is generative AI camp, they also have two groups. One is like, it's gonna take away my job. And it's another kind of buzzword that doesn't really work. So, you know, it's...
Already? Thanks just like that? Us, no?
That was probably the best part of the interview.
Yeah, I think, yeah. Goran, thanks for being a part of the show.
Thank you.
We are starting at the end, actually, so welcome everyone to another episode.
It's going to be like Pulp Fiction, you know? It's going to be the last scene. It's going to be the
reveal
first.
And yeah. No, happy to be here. It's the last day of the Mainframe Technical Exchange here in Prague. We're all a little tired. It's been high energy week, lots of conversations, but I haven't really got the chance to have a conversation with Goran. And Goran is an interesting fellow. He wears lots of hats. And so let's start there, actually, Goran. What do you do in Broadcom?
Thanks, Zach. Thanks for having me here. yeah, I'm a member of the product management team. And I'm one of the senior members of the team. Mm-hmm. I'm involved in strategy. My title is offering manager.
Okay.
Work with people who are customer facing. I work with engineers, I work with product managers, so I work with everybody involved in the, let's call it a life cycle of a product.
Yes.
And that includes adoption and everything that the product goes through until end of life. And I'm also involved in generative AI.
Gen AI?
Yeah, I did mention that word. And that's a part of my work where I have a product management hat, work with a select group of clients and a dedicated team that we have put together in order to understand and learn how generative AI can benefit our customers in the work that they are doing around development, maintenance, and modernization of COBOL and other ZOS applications.
Here's our first cliffhanger, because rather than going into more detail right on that, which I'm sure many of you want to know about, let's actually step back, because we're at the MTE,
sure.
And GenAI is definitely on everybody's minds. I've heard that from many people. While they're interested in, you know, certain solutions that they're using, they want to know what Broadcom is doing. But before we go there, I want to ask you, what have you heard from customers? Where are customers with generative AI?
Oh, yeah. So it has been a really great time discussing this topic with customers. Everybody's interested in it, as you can imagine. And so I would say there are a couple of camps, groups of people. Especially, this is a technical conference, so we have technical audience, and a lot of the technical people are playing with Copilot, Microsoft Copilot, learning from it and trying to apply it on their daily tasks.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one group.
Yep.
And then there is a large group of people who are wondering what generative AI is and isn't.
Yes.
And you know, we talked before the recording started, and as I mentioned then, you know, some of them are wondering, like, is it really so advanced that it can take away my job? And others maybe think that it's just another, like, fancy word for statistics that, you know, they had in school.
Yeah, it's a marketing thing for now. Maybe there's not as much promise, at least initially.
Oh, there is a lot of promise, and I think that what is happening is pretty much a revolution in how we utilize technology.
Yeah.
And so there is a reason why we are investing in generative AI. And I think that everybody has a sense of potential there, that's something new and transformational. And we can talk about, you know, what that means. But it's really fundamentally how we interact with technology, because in a way, you know, we are used to issue commands and get a response. You know, we felt ownership over the technology,
yes.
Right? And now we have these assistants where we have to ask nicely and appropriately if we want something to be done. And we need to think about how we ask the question in order to get the best possible answer. So it's really like having a, I don't know if it's going to actually sound correctly, but let's say a summer intern involved on a project, and you know that summer intern came with certain skills, and we are trying to figure out how can that summer intern learn and also grow and become a part of the project.
And specifically, to get a context to really provide that help.
Yeah, right? The context is really important.
Now, given your role in our team and how you've really, I mean, as the offering manager specifically,
right.
and really from taking a product to market to end of life, as you mentioned, I mean, you're uniquely positioned to understand all the different areas where GenAI could help our
sure.
customers and ourselves, right? So I'm curious if you would jump in a little bit to what we're doing and at least some of the areas we've initially looked at or where our project is kind of going or pointed towards.
Yeah, so in general, I mean, just for orientation, generative AI is sort of a special type, a subcategory of machine learning.
Yeah.
And it's really good at generating content.
Yes.
Right? And so when we go about how best to utilize it, we are looking for areas where it can learn, process information, and then generate content for us. And everybody's using it to improve the way they write emails and essays, and kids use it in school. And then in the software development world, it's also used to generate code examples mm-hmm. to help people be more productive. In our situation, in our industry, there is a lot of code being written.
Yes.
And so we are focused on building the understanding of that code. But since this is a generative AI, we are asking assistants to create content for us to explain, to find, to describe. And another area where we started using generative AI in is and have a project going on, and I hope I'm not introducing it for the first time, so now you know, it's in the support system.
Yes.
Because, you know, again, where does it help accelerate delivery of value is when you have a lot of unstructured content. You know, traditionally what we would do, we would assign a group of summer interns to
get this in order, yeah.
To structure it, to put it in a database, to create a new document, to create an index and things like that in order to answer specific questions. Here, we just give this content to the generative AI assistant and say, ask questions. You can ask questions. And then we rely on a generative assistant to be able to index and parse all those different seemingly separate pieces of information and combine them, generate the answer to our question. And so we are in process of doing that on the support side because, as you know, we write a lot of technical nodes, we
yes.
have a lot of products. They are all related one way or well, some of them are more related to the problem at hand.
Yes.
And so we have done research in using the technology to help our customers find better answers for the technical problems that they have. And so that's another area. I mean, there are others. And what's important and what we're doing now, if you're asking me, and I know you're
asking. You're talking about coding.
Yeah, I'm talking about coding. And I mentioned in general, like, the areas of interest for us. You know, because there's millions of lines of code that it's not often well documented, you know, sometimes partially documented, where people who have created this code, maintain it, who understand it, are slowly retiring.
Yes.
And that's a big challenge for the organizations that run their business on that code. And this is a really, really important challenge for them, mm-hmm. that we are trying to help them. And but if you ask me what exactly, how exactly
does it work? I
don't want
to poke you too much, yeah. But yeah.
So that's still, I think that's still work in progress. I think it's fair to say that devil is in the detail.
Yeah.
And, you know, while there is a promise, there is an opportunity, I think we are still, the whole industry is honing in on the use cases that really matter.
And really, I mean, that first example you mentioned with kind of the bringing together all the documentation to help support, right? I mean, that's functionally, you know, doing analysis of content in order to spit out answers. And one of the things that we've found from a number of our studies and other studies is that on the coding side, it's actually a lot about the analysis before coding. And so that's where taking what code we want to necessarily use for training and then providing kind of that analysis side is one of the things I think that we're looking at quite a bit, right?
Again, yeah, at the high level, I agree. Analysis is an element of that. You could also, so we may cut this part.
No, it's okay, yeah.
You know, it may be actually part of that may be avoiding analysis, right? And typically the analysis was the way to do it, right? You have a lot of information, And you have your task. A task is, there is a new tax code, right? Or there is a new field, we need to change a table. Like there's something like that. Often the tasks related to maintenance of existing applications are not always build new functionality, although that is the case too. But sometimes the tasks are very precisely determined that people get these tasks that are very specific, and then they have to apply it on a sea of code that they don't really understand.
Sea of code, literally, that can be in a single module even, so it's just daunting.
And that must continue to be extremely reliable, because that's one of the main reasons for its existence, right? Performant, reliable, and so they have a challenge, obviously, in accomplishing that relatively straightforward task. But the challenge is, if I start making changes to something I don't understand that's very complex, there is a chance that I may introduce a problem, and nobody wants that. And so that's why people spend a lot of time doing the analysis, meaning trying to understand the relationships, trying to do the impact analysis, trying to absorb as much information that they can in order to do the right thing. But if you kind of try to cut through this, you know, they are trying to answer specific questions. They use analysis in order to get the right pieces of information and connect them into the answer and evaluate the validity of that answer and have confidence in doing that. And that we are trying to reduce the time for analysis by giving them the answer. And what is difficult is when you give them the answer. We will give them the answer. Generative AI will give the answer.
Yes, and possible answers, yes.
We are confident that generative AI will provide an answer.
Yeah.
What is hard is validate that answer and get confidence in something that generative AI has created.
You gave a very nice description of why we are taking it kind of step by step to understand customers' needs, but also in our kind of whole working cycle where we can take benefit of Gen AI. I kind of want to bring it back to MTE,
sure.
Because you had two successful sessions, a lot of people, kind of packed room, I think, for both of them.
Right.
And one of them was kind of a workshop, right?
Yep.
And so people got to be hands-on keyboard and kind of see some of the generation that is capable now. So what's something you'd want people to take away from this topic, or even attending your workshop here, or workshops which you can learn for them in the future?
I mean, two things happen every time we interact with new users. The first is, well, of course we learn a lot. Right, so our software is in early stages, I mean, relatively, meaning that there are still things that we discover that because we use it every day, we don't notice. For example, the indication of progress is not visible in a room with a lot of light when you use, when you use the light version of the interface of VS Code.
Yeah.
You know, on a dark version that we all use, you see it very well. And in a bright room, people didn't see it, right? So we learn things like that, that have to do with basic usability. And then the other thing that happens is people who try the technology, they learn that it's different. You know, what I mentioned earlier on, that you can ask questions. So everybody approaches it with the same mentality of, I'm going to issue a command, explain this to me. And then they get an answer, and they're looking at it, it's like, well, this is not really what I wanted, but this is kind of cool. And then we tell them, well, you can ask a sub question, like you can follow up and ask, well, tell me more about this. And, oh, I can do that. Yes. And then you get another answer, which is better, a little bit better than the previous one. Right. And then they realize, how about if I ask another question, you know, what's going to happen? And we're like, we never asked this question, so we don't really know what's going to happen, but let's take a look. And it gets very interesting and very exciting. So it also does look like a research project a little bit when you do that.
Of course.
Right? So and that's part of the reason why I'm generally very conservative as a product person. I want to validate as much as possible. So I think these are the situations where we are all like very excited and we leave the room, and you know, later on when we talk about this, like now, you know, I realize like we need more work, more validation.
Yes.
In order to be able to deliver that confidence that people need.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Goran, thanks so much for joining, because it really is a really hot topic. Tendency is for people to get maybe too excited or sort of overstate what can be done. And I really appreciate your nuanced view and kind of guidance to, you know, we're taking our time. There's a lot of value that can already be gained, but there's a lot of places where we need to do more research with you in order to understand what you ultimately desire to get that kind of confidence.
Thank you. I think you guys are doing a really fantastic job with this, these interviews. And I look forward to seeing what you guys are going to come up with this time.
And reach out to this guy if you want more information about what we're doing with GenAI. Goran, thank you.
Thank you very much.